How's this for a cutting personality assessment? One of Sting's own bandmates reckons the singer-songwriter is an egotist, a narcissist, and a misanthrope. Ouch. Well, having just spent some time with him in New York, I think that's rather unfair. But the rock and roll icon is certainly self-assured. And why not? He's now been at the top of his game for 40 years and happily refuses to ever stop making music.
Don't drink coffee, I take tea, my dear. I like my toast on one side.
That's Hell's Kitchen.
Walking the wet streets of Manhattan, I'm with the most famous Englishman in New York.
I'm an Englishman in New York.
A walk is a story, at the beginning, a middle, and an end.
Do your stories get interrupted by fans as you walk the streets of New York?
They may do. Not today, though. People are far too busy trying to stay dry.
With houses on three continents and a life on the road, Sting considers himself a citizen of the world. But it's in this city this showman feels most at home.
You know, I'm British and we're not prone to being impressed very easily, particularly by our own. We are whinging palms, as you call us. You know, I think there's some truth in that. I feel it, so I'm more comfortable here.
Right. Does that mean you're too much of a tall poppy?
Yeah, I think I'm divisive in England. You know, I don't really belong to a class anymore. So it's better to be in a society like this, which is a little freer.
Roxanne, you don't have to wear that dress tonight.
Divisive or polarizing, 65-year-old Sting is the first to admit that's a small price to pay for an outrageously successful career that has spanned 40 years. While Sting's solo work has now eclipsed even that remarkable triumph.
For me, success is to just carve a little bit of freedom here and a little bit of freedom there so I can just play. I'm just having fun.
You would have the most freedom, wouldn't you? I mean, wouldn't you be at that stage of your career and your life that you get to choose exactly what you want to
you'd
do?
You'd be surprised, though, that people at my point in the game actually do stick with exactly what they do, and they do it very well. I have no plan for world domination. I really just follow what makes me interested. So I, you know, 7 years ago I made an album of lute songs from the 16th century, much to the chagrin of my record company. I did an orchestral record, I wrote a Broadway show, I did an album of winter songs, you know, of folk songs and Schubert. And my whole thing is that the most important thing in music for me is surprise.
If you're always trying to be unpredictable, is that predictable in its own way?
It could be. It could be. I mean, I have no idea what's going to happen next.
The surprise for fans this time around is that his new album is a reflection of the old. 57th and 9th is named after the busy street corner that interrupts his daily walk to work at the Avatar recording studio.
My room is 25.
Well, you'd have to stop here because there's a two-way street and it's, you know, the taxis will kill you if they can. So I would always use this place to sort of take stock of my life, just in case it's the end of my life.
There does seem to be a real sense of excitement that you've returned to rock and roll, is how it's been put. Do you get that sense? Do you feel that?
Yeah, I mean, people will say, oh, you know, you've gone back to the Police. Well, I say, look, let me remind you, I was in that band. It's part of my DNA that I'm very proud of, but I haven't made a rock record in a long time.
50,000 voices rising.
None of the songs were pre-planned. They're written subconsciously almost. At the beginning of this year, I lost a lot of colleagues, notably David Bowie, Prince, Glenn Frey from the Eagles. So I think it makes you question your own mortality, and having been in that position myself, you know, night after night, being in the spotlight, being the total center of attention, people singing your songs back at you, that's a very heady experience, which is difficult to explain. It's also psychologically dangerous. You can become empowered in a very hubristic sort of, you know, hey, look at me, I'm immortal. I don't think you learn much philosophy up there.
Through your life, have you ever fallen into the trap of being overcome by hubris?
Me?
You.
I was lucky in that I didn't become famous until I was 27. So before that, I'd had a job. I was a school teacher. I was a father at 23, a husband, paid tax, had a pension plan, voted, right? I had a normal, ordinary life. So that gave me a perspective when the ludicrous life of stardom took over. I don't think I fell for the hubristic trap at all. Maybe, you know, for a little while, but not too much.
You are human, after all.
I'm very human.
Many have gone before us and now. Many tried and failed somehow.
Sting's new album also remembers his earliest dreams to flee the bleak far north of England and to flee his family.
Heading south on the Great North Road. South on the Great North Road.
I became a musician very early on. I got a guitar. My mother was a piano player. My father sang a little bit, and when they weren't fighting, they performed together, which wasn't very often. But I definitely wanted to escape, and I didn't feel I belonged, ever. You know, I rejected my family. It wasn't particularly, you know, successful family or happy family.
Do you have regrets that you're decision to go back and embrace and forgive didn't happen in their lifetime?
No, it didn't. My parents died very young. My mother was 54, my father was barely 60. I did reconcile in a way. I went to see them before they died, but not enough, you know, not enough. I needed to spend more time with them. I miss them now. They should still be alive, which would be interesting. Or not. I don't know. You never know.
Well, you have a theory on why they died so young,
don't you? Yeah. I mean, they weren't a happy couple at all. And I think that was a toxicity in the relationship which actually created disease in them both, you know. I, fortunately, am much happier in my domestic romantic situation, so I feel I'm at least immune in that sense. But who knows, you know?
I like how you describe a domestic romantic situation.
Well, I've been married to a woman, the same woman, for 35 years. And people say to me, well, what's your secret? I don't have a secret. We just like each other.
Remember me when the west wind moves.
She is Trudy Styler, and they have shared a life of common passions, including the environment and the arts.
She comes into a room, she lights the room up for me, still.
So it sounds truly romantic then.
It's very romantic. I mean, she's an extraordinary person. Somebody said to me the other day, who's the most extraordinary person you've ever met? Expecting, I'll say, you know, Nelson Mandela or, you know, one of these grand statesmen. I'll say, I think I'm married to her. And I that's true.
Do you think she'd say the same about you?
No.
You sure?
No, she sort of tolerates me. Yeah.
Sting has 6 children, 2 from his first marriage and 4 with Trudy.
Hello, are you home? I need to kill some time.
Their model and musician daughter, Elliot Sumner, is closely following in Dad's footsteps.
Well, everybody needs a confidant for all that wreckage kept inside.
My youngest daughter, Elliot, is actually in the charts with me at the moment in America. She's slightly behind me, but I'm looking over my shoulder, but that makes me so proud. We just forward,
too soon to burn, but we can wait. But being the offspring of Sting is not necessarily easy, to take the things we crave, nor is being a dad.
It's been a difficult balancing act, to be honest with you, because I'm a travelling musician. My job is to travel the whole time, and to balance that with a family life is not easy. My kids have had a lot of privilege in some ways. You know, they've seen the world. They have a very, very sophisticated geopolitical sense. But did I come home every night and help them with the homework? No, I did not.
And no resentment for not being there to do the homework?
Yeah, a little bit. You know, you weren't there, Dad. And when you did pick us up from school, all the mothers wanted your autograph. It's a kind of embarrassment, you know. Yeah, but they were very outspoken about what was wrong, which I'm glad about, and still are.
It seems to have worked. This father and grandfather is down to earth. Unexpectedly so for a man who has reached and for decades enjoyed the pinnacle of stardom. A man who has the freedom to do whatever he wants. I don't care if you
exist. So, Sting, at 65, and
yes.
As rich as God, as you've been described by one music insider.
As rich as God.
As rich as God. Mm. What drives you now? What keeps you going?
What's next? A surprise. A surprise for me, you know. I'm still looking, I'm still curious.
So retirement is not on the cards.
So that's what?
Not retirement is not the great surprise.
I don't really understand that word. Retirement. I think I'd die. I'd have to learn oil painting or something, or take up brain surgery. I don't know, it'd have to be something absorbing to replace music. And I don't think it exists, so I'm not going to retire.